let's begin with this lecture. Very specifically, these units and subunits mentioned in the UGC syllabus will be directly and indirectly connected to what I am going to talk about in this particular class. Only thing is, as I have been saying for the last couple of lectures, it is important that we do not focus only on very specific issues and content related to these topics, but we also learn how to develop a framework to understand these issues about citizens' actions, conservation ethic, role of individuals, the enforcement of environmental legislation, and so on. Now, in the previous class, I was talking about issues of equity, access, and justice. Problems related to equity, access, and justice with reference to environment and natural resources, these are what lead to conflicts and struggles over natural resources. And as I have repeatedly emphasized, environmental sociologists and historians have stressed that in India, the primary environmental issue is one of struggle and conflict over resources, not one of conservation as it has been largely in the West. So from that perspective, we need to understand why these kind of topics have been put in the UGC syllabus. Just for emphasis, that point that has been made by Ramchandra Guha, I've put it on top there. Some of the questions related to conflict and the problem of equity and access are these. Who owns resources? Is it owned by the government? Is it owned by a private company? Was it owned in common by a group of people, a community? Is it owned by individuals? And what are the consequences? So is it better if government owns, controls, regulates, manages environmental resources, or is it better if it is privately owned and managed? Or if villages, panchayats, municipal corporations, NGOs manage them? What kind of technologies should be used for more efficient use of resources? So for example, you have a drinking water project. What kind of technologies are useful? Or if you want to channelize river waters for through canals for irrigation, what kind of technologies are better? And who makes these decisions about technologies? Is it made on the basis of by politicians? Is it made by bureaucrats, by technocrats? Is there people's participation? So we find that these issues determine what choices we make about environmental management, and in turn, how efficiently they are managed, and with what consequences for environmental degradation. So as an exercise, you could probably do with your own students about ownership of different kinds of resources in your own neighborhoods, in your own area, in your town, village, and so on. And this could be small water bodies, this could be forest patches, this could be mangroves, pasture, green grassland. So these different kinds of resources, who owns the, is it government, which government agency, is it the revenue department, is it the forest department, is it a municipal corporation, is it a town development authority, who manage them? In many cities, for example, some of these resources like parks have been handed over from management to NGOs or to local communities. So in terms of ownership, and then who gets to access these resources, who gets to manage these resources, water, forest, grassland, parks, and so on, and what are the environmental consequences, positive or negative? This kind of an exercise is something that you can do as part of one of the final modules mentioned in the UGC syllabus, which is a field trip. So that could connect very well to these kinds of issues. Further, we can ask more fundamental questions about why are there struggles and conflicts around natural resources in the first place. If countries like India are characterized by these struggles around environment on a very large scale, almost everywhere in India, what are the reasons for these? And why is it that resources are not shared equally, which is one of the reasons for these conflicts, whether it's mineral resources or forests or water bodies, rivers, and so on? Some of these conflicts also relate to what kind of governance should exist about regarding resources. So should we have formal legislation, rules and regulations by government? Are these more effective? What about traditional customs and traditions, which are prevalent almost everywhere for managing resources? In Mumbai, for example, there's been a long-standing customary ban on fishing during the monsoon because that is the season when fish spawn or breed. So during that season, if you do fishing, then there'll be no fish in subsequent seasons. But this was this customary law, if you like to call it, was broken by migrant fisherfolk from other parts. So the fisherfolk of Mumbai campaigned to make this into a law, the government. On the other hand, you have this example of Sariska, which I was mentioning earlier, the tiger reserve, which completely eliminated all kinds of customary management of the forest. Government had complete control over it. The end result was not a single tiger was left. So you have other cases where there are combinations of these different forms of governance and management systems. So in module 4 of Environment and Society, we are going to look at common pool resources, where we are going to discuss the views of Professor Eleanor Ostrom, the Nobel Prize winner in economics, who in fact talks about these different ways of management of resources and talks about their implications not only for efficiency but also for equity, access and so on. So if resource degradation occurs, is it because everybody doesn't have a say in management of resources that there are issues of power where some people exclude, say the government excludes others from participating in management and therefore resource degradation occurs? Is it because some people are able to bribe their way into, you know, letting out untreated effluents into a water body? So these are also social science issues which students should be alerted to. And of course, the earlier issue that I mentioned yesterday, which is going to be taken up in the economics module by Professor Narayanan, about the ability to pay. So these are also, this issue is fundamentally related to the equity issue, because on the one hand, some social scientists, economists, policymakers argue that resources are not always priced according to their value, and therefore there's a lot of wastage. On the other hand, resources are, like water, are a basic necessity. And therefore, we have to make sure that those who do not have the ability to pay also should have access to these kinds of resources. So what I would suggest is that the kind of question that I'm asking in this slide and the previous slide, these you can use in the classroom for discussion, like I mentioned a few points now. You can ask the students to develop case studies with reference to specific resources in your own backyard and ask them to do surveys and get some responses to these kinds of questions, or you can design quizzes for these kinds of issues. Two video resources that I want to share, I'm not going to show them, we don't have enough time. One is a very good presentation by the Delhi Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal. Of course, this was before he became the Chief Minister, before the Aam Aadmi Party was even formed actually, when he was running an NGO, where he talks about the privatization of water. There was a plan to privatize water, drinking water in Delhi. And what are the legal implications? What are the issues of participation? And what are the implications for equitable access to water in Delhi for everybody? Is something he talks about in that. The second is about water politics in Mumbai, which was made by a famous Indian-American anthropologist called Arjun Appadurai, which again talks about on the one hand, the nature of the bureaucracy, which provides drinking water to the city, which involves alienation of some people from access to water. Like we discussed yesterday, water has to be taken away from certain communities in rural areas to be supplied to Mumbai. And within Mumbai also, in terms of who has a greater ability to pay and so on. On the other hand, you also see that the lower level bureaucracy invokes certain traditional values about how water is a basic need and what we are doing is actually some kind of a religious duty, and therefore we have to provide water to everybody irrespective of whether they are able to pay or not. And therefore many studies in Mumbai show that whether people are able to pay or not, whether they have a legal connection or not, the municipal corporation officials go out of their way to provide water to everybody because they think it's a basic need. So let me take up a few examples, and you could probably take up more examples from various kinds of resource conflicts and use them in the classroom to discuss issues of equity, institutions, governance, and so on. So forest resources, forestry as a natural resource, has been one of the cases where there has been conflict for more than 200 years now, from the British days, in fact. So those of you who are familiar with the Indian freedom movement will know that there were a lot of tribal movements against the British rule, because primarily the British took complete control over forests over which local people had access. So at one go, anybody who was using a forest resource became a criminal. It became illegal, even though they had been doing it for hundreds of years, which is one of the reasons why many of these tribal leaders like Alluri Sitaramaraju in Andhra or Birsa Munda in Jharkhand, they launched these movements and revolts against British rule. Now, unfortunately, what happened was after independence, the Indian government followed the same principle of stating that forests belong to the government, and therefore anybody who uses forest resources for any purpose is by definition performing an illegal activity. On the other hand, there has also been a lot of collusion between the forest departments and various timber merchants, paper mills, sports goods manufacturers, and so on, which led to over-exploitation of the forest, such that even though the Indian constitution requires that we maintain the forest cover of 33%, it is less than, it's about 25 or less in India today. So this kind of a deforestation that's been happening, legal and illegal, has led to a lot of conflicts between local communities dependent on forests and the government forest department. So what one could do, and one must remember here that this, the population we are talking of who are involved in these conflicts is not minor. Okay, by various estimates, this is about 100 million, which is larger than most countries in the world. So the number of people who are dependent on forests as per the Forest Rights Act of 2006 is around 100 million or more. So we are talking about a huge population which is dependent on forestry for their lives and livelihood. Therefore, it is very important that we understand the context in which these kinds of conflicts are taking place, because it affects the lives and livelihoods of a very large number of people. So we've had various policies over the last 60 years or so after independence, including on social forestry, which one of you mentioned the other day, joint forest management, and so on. We also have Forest Conservation Act, the Forest Rights Act. We've given you links to these earlier. So what we would suggest is that you use various materials, some of which I've already uploaded on Moodle, as well as videos and case studies of these movements around forest deforestation, the Chipko movement, of course, which is the most famous one in India, in Uttarakhand. And we'll talk about the movement itself a little later. There's a similar movement in North Karnataka called Apiko, which means the same, to hug trees. Then Lekha Menda is a village in Gadchiroli district of Maharashtra, which is the first village in India to fight for and get their rights under the Forest Rights Act. So it's very interesting that the government refused to implement its own law, and people had to fight to get the law implemented. Okay, you can just search for videos on these cases. There's also a documentary called Jungle Tales on North Karnataka, where a number of international forestry experts from around the world give their views on how the forestry has been degraded over a century or more. Similarly, there have also been a lot of conflicts over water resources. In India, we see conflicts between states, between regions within a state, between different countries in South Asia, India, Bangladesh, India, Pakistan, and so on. Conflicts over dams, which is also water related. Increasingly also, overutilization of groundwater. Earlier, it was mostly surface water. With increasing exploitation of groundwater, pumping out of groundwater is happening on a very large scale. So that is also leading to certain conflicts. For example, against the Coca-Cola plant in a village called Plachimada in Kerala, where it was seen that Coca-Cola was extracting groundwater on a very large scale, resulting in the groundwater table going down and farmers not able to access water. In fact, the groundwater exploitation is in India is so serious that, you know, recently I was talking to a geographer who was telling me that northern India and Pakistan together extract so much of groundwater that it is actually contributing to sea level rise. Okay? So it's happening on a very large scale. And so the scarcity of resources, of water as a resource, and the conflicts that arise from these could also be interesting case studies to discuss issues of equity and access and why, how these lead to conflicts. Again, the some of the environmental movements related to this is I'll take up in a little while. It would also be interesting if you can identify different parties involved in these movements. So is it a state versus another state, Karnataka versus Tamil Nadu over Kaveri, or Tamil Nadu versus Kerala over Mullaperiyar Dam? It could be Andhra versus Telangana over the Godavari and Tungabhadra and other rivers. It could be people versus government, people versus corporate firm. It could be against multipurpose projects like the Narmada Dam and so on. So like in the case of the forests, I would suggest you take up case studies of Narmada or Terry Dam in the Uttarakhand, the Kaveri dispute, the Mullaperiyar dispute or Plachimada, and find out ask the students to discuss about who are the different parties involved, why is there a conflict in the first place, is it related to the use of a specific kind of technology, is it related to particular kinds of laws, outdated laws which are not able to address the current conflicts, is it because of power issues that certain parties are more powerful than others. Okay, so those kinds of issues can be brought in. Also, the timing is very important. So in India, we see that the conflicts between states over river waters actually starts in the 1970s, not before. And that's very interesting because that is related to the Green Revolution, which began to be implemented from the late 1960s onwards. So the Green Revolution introduced certain kinds of varieties of plants which actually required more water, more irrigation. So a change in the agricultural cropping pattern resulted in an increased demand for water, and that is when, you know, these kinds of river water disputes, Ravi and Bias between Haryana and Punjab, Himachal Pradesh and so on also started at that time. So one kind of environmental change in agriculture resulted in demand for other kinds of resources which created conflicts in those areas. So Vandana Shiva has an excellent book called The Violence of the Green Revolution, where she talks about these issues. Also, she has a book on water conflicts in India where these kinds of issues are discussed. More recently, the last 10 to 15 years, there has been a change in our policy towards mineral resources. So earlier, before 1991, mining was an activity restricted to the government of India, not even the state governments. It was a central, it came under the aegis of the central jurisdiction of the central government. But since the 1990s, we have allowed private sector, global and Indian, to also enter the mining sector. And we know there have been a lot of conflicts over the POSCO in Orissa, Jadugoda in Jharkhand. So there have been many struggles around minerals and mining. For some reason, which is only known to whoever made the earth, most of the mineral resources are under forests in India, which means it primarily affects forestry, but it also affects the 100 million people living in or around forests. So on the one hand, there is this issue of minerals required for economic development and growth. On the other hand, there are these millions of people who need to be displaced because of these mining activities. So that's the reason why mining has become a significant arena for conflicts also in recent years. Those who are interested in this may look up the Samata judgment, which is an interesting judgment of the Supreme Court of India in response to a petition filed by an NGO called Samata, which tries to arrive at a solution wherein what we call as win-win situation, you know, where the local people can benefit from certain amounts of mining activity and you can also generate minerals for economic development of the country. Also recently, there have been conflicts around nuclear power, those of you who have been following environmental disasters will know that there have been significant nuclear disasters, Chernobyl in Russia and Three Mile Island in the US in the 80s and 70s respectively. More recently, you had the Fukushima disaster, which has completely changed our idea of what constitutes risk and safety and how we should deal with disasters, because Japan was known to be one of the most risk-averse societies. They are supposed to have had the best safety mechanisms of any country in the world, and yet something like Fukushima happened, which is one of the largest environmental disasters in recent history. And therefore, how are we as a country looking at nuclear issues? Because Kudankulam in Tamil Nadu, in terms of its location, is very similar to Fukushima because it is also located on the sea coast. Similarly, Jetapur nuclear plant in Maharashtra is also located on the sea coast. Some of you must have read in the newspapers about a sea rally that was taken out by fishermen in Jetapur against this particular project. So there are environmental issues, but there are also issues of displacement of local people who have livelihood activities there and who have to move out because of this. So this is another arena for conflicts around natural resources that's becoming important now. Finally, and this is one of the important topics mentioned in the UGC syllabus, this is the issue of resettlement and rehabilitation. We've had a number of struggles against these, famous ones being in Singur and Nandigram in West Bengal, the Mahua cement project in Gujarat, resettlement issues relating to various multipurpose dams, mining projects, airports, ports, and other infrastructure projects. Now, essentially, when we talk about resettlement and rehabilitation, we focus mostly on the human aspect, the human beings who have to be resettled and rehabilitated. Rarely do we talk about the environmental dimension of this. And I would like you in your classrooms to bring in the environmental dimension in a larger way. And this can be done in two ways. One, in the project area itself, people may be displaced willingly or unwillingly, voluntarily or involuntarily, but there is also certain damage caused to the environment because of the project. As per the Environmental Protection Act, certain measures are to be taken both to minimize environmental damage as well as to compensate for it. So if forests are destroyed, you have to plant more trees. If a mangrove is destroyed, you have to restore mangroves somewhere else and so on. This is rarely done or implemented. Okay? So recently, the National Green Tribunal has begun taking up this area. So that's one very important aspect of project management that we have to make the students aware of. Secondly, once resettlement takes place, usually it does not consider the environmental dependence of human population. So they may be given a house somewhere else, they may be given training to take up jobs, but what about water supply, what about sanitation? If these households who move to a different place have cattle, sheep, buffaloes, cows, is there grazing land there? Will it be developed? If these are fisher folk who are being displaced, are they moved to another place where they can practice fisheries? In the case of the Narmada Dam, for example, a lot of farmers were given compensation in the form of money, but not compensation in the form of agricultural land which they could cultivate. Or if agricultural land was given, it was usually barren land, not suitable for cultivation. So the environmental dimension, that human beings are fundamentally dependent on environment, and number two, that a very large proportion of those who are displaced due to these kinds of projects are people who are called as ecosystem people by Guha and Gadgil. Therefore, when they are resettled and rehabilitated, they have to be resettled and rehabilitated in environmental terms also, which is usually not taken care of by the various kind of policies. At this point, maybe I'll just take one or two questions. Siliguri, Institute of Technology, Darjeeling.
See, this is a very interesting and important lecture you are telling, because the conflict is about the resources actually. And as the population is growing, so how it is possible to manage the land actually? Land, there's a problem with land.
Okay. How is it possible to manage the land? Now, this is, you know, one of the difficult issues we are facing today, because land, for whatever purposes it is used, was not predominantly thought of as an environmental issue. It did not feature in much of the environmental debates, because we're talking about land parceled out to individuals, individual firms, and so on. So most of the movements have been about large resources, large water bodies, forests, and there have been collectives or large groups using these resources, or there have been disasters which affected large numbers of people. But land was a private property owned by individuals or individual firms. And this was used for many different purposes. And historically, it was very difficult to mobilize people when land degradation took place. It was also difficult to identify what are the environmental consequences. It's only recently that this has become an important issue. Like I was talking about the Plachimada Coca-Cola case, where it was a private property land, but then it had an impact on the surrounding areas, both because of leaching of chemicals into the soil and because of excessive extraction of groundwater. So likewise, in many other cases also, now we are able to understand that certain kinds of activities on individual small parcels of land can have larger consequences for air pollution, soil pollution, water pollution, and so on. So I'm glad you asked this question, because there is very little literature on this. There's a large amount of literature on land grab right now, but again, it's not quite focusing on the environmental dimension. So I would suggest that all of you reflect and think about this and see how this can be discussed in a much more vibrant and comprehensive way with the students. So as a result of these kinds of conflicts and struggles around resources, we've had a very large number of environmental movements. Primarily, these are to do with collective mobilization of people around issues of concern, which links environment to livelihoods and life. So here, what we do in our classroom, and what I suggest you also do, is to use case studies to explain the relationship between all of those things that I mentioned on this slide. Environment, what is the policy towards environment, what kind of technology choice are making. So if it is irrigation, for example, is it large dams, medium dams, small dams, village tanks, rainwater harvesting structures, issues of livelihood, resettlement, justice, equity, biodiversity. So when we talk of resettlement and rehabilitation, again, the environmental dimension has to incorporate biodiversity issues. So one of the criticisms in the case of large dams is that they do not compensate for the biodiversity loss because of submersion of land and due to these reservoirs. What happens to common lands which are not owned by private or public, wasteland, forests, grazing land, which provide sources of livelihood to people? So some of these case studies I will mention in the next few minutes or so, but you can search for more case studies of environmental movements, again from your own region, so that students can relate to them better. As I mentioned a few slides ago, there's been a long history of resistance to environmental encroachment and resource grab, especially in countries like India, but also in South America and other parts of Asia, in Africa. So the colonial period marked the first time when resources belonging to the people were taken over by a foreign entity on a very large scale. And it was made illegal for the people who owned these resources to actually use those resources subsequently. So the East India Company, the British East India Company, the Dutch East India Company, and so on, came to India primarily because they saw that countries like India were rich in various kinds of resources, whether these are minerals or plants, spices, textiles, and so on. So the primary objective of colonialism in the beginning was to exploit these resources, take them back to their own countries. So this problem of what is called as a resource curse in environmental studies continues, and it is seen most obviously in the case of Africa. Some of you must have seen this movie Blood Diamond, where a range of international actors use very violent and illegal methods to get control of the diamond industry in many African countries, in Congo especially. But also we see that this kind of issue has been raised in the case of Jharkhand. You know, the mining scam in Jharkhand, for example, is something that reflects this. So Jharkhand is a state which is extremely rich in resources. But this resource has not benefited the population of Jharkhand, which continues to be poor. So there are external entities which come and make huge profits out of this. So what we see normally as a blessing turns into a curse because of the lack of appropriate institutions to harness these resources for local development purposes. Where this does not happen, there is resistance and there are environmental movements. So the best example is the CHIPCO movement, which, as you know, was a movement in the early 1970s, where people in the Alaknanda Valley in the early 1970s experienced a huge flood, which was not happening before on the same scale. And then it began to be repeated year after year. And the local people then gradually realized that this was related to deforestation, because trees, as you know, put down roots, which prevent the soil from getting eroded. Once deforestation takes place, the soil gets eroded, flooding becomes much more easier. And of course, the cutting down of trees also meant there was less fodder available for the animals, the cattle, sheep, goats, on which local populations were dependent. So how this idea of CHIPCO, that is hugging the trees to prevent the trees from being cut when the companies were coming to cut the trees, is explained in this YouTube video by Sundarlal Bahuguna. The picture that you see on the top is not documented in history, but there are oral histories. It's part of the narratives that people tell you about one of the kings in the state of Rajasthan, who was cutting down trees on a very large number to build a huge palace for himself. And then a lot of the local people hugged the trees when the king's men came to cut the trees. So this is some kind of a part legend, part mythology. But I myself heard these stories in villages in Rajasthan. So there is some kind of history, some kind of indigenous mobilization, tradition, and environmental ethic, which became famous as CHIPCO. But you hear similar stories from around India, all over India. So the problem started when the government began to hand over a lease of forest to paper mills and loggers, to sporting goods manufacturers for making cricket bats, baseball bats, and so on. So the local people initially protested, saying that, you know, these are a source of livelihood for us. So Chandi Prasad Bhatt, whom you see below, initially his idea was that local people should be given access to these trees so that they can make half-finished bats or some kind of paper, which can then be given to companies for making finished goods so that local people get employment. Eventually, they changed their position because the women in these communities pointed out that deforestation or cutting down trees reduces fodder, creates floods, creates disasters, and so on. And therefore, the trees should not be cut. That's it. Okay? And there's no negotiation on this. So from a women's perspective, what are the key issues related to the CHIPCO movement? Why is deforestation such a big problem for us? So the picture that you see in the middle, these are some of the women who were part of the original movement in the 1970s who are still living. So 30 years later, they were interviewed. And this video shows that, revisiting the CHIPCO movement. So what is the women's perspective? What did women have to gain from the forests because of which they were totally opposed to this kind of a project. Interestingly, this video also talks about the long history of this, that the British initially wanted to exploit resources here, and the first round of major deforestation in Uttarakhand happened when, for railways and roadworks, large amount of trees were cut in this particular region. So there's a long history of deforestation which culminated in this kind of a movement. Yeah. More recently, we have the Forest Rights Act. Again, this is a movement that is not commonly mentioned in textbooks because it is very recent, but because it affects a very large number of people and because it's one of the few cases where successful legal and policy transformation has taken place with reference to environment in India, it's a good case study to take up. So as I was mentioning earlier, both the British government and the government of India transferred forest resources to the government, making it illegal to access any forest resource for people who were dependent on them for centuries. Therefore, from the 70s and 80s onwards, there was a significant movement by many environmental and forest activists to change the law, to say that local people must have, number one, a say in managing the forest, and number two, some access to resources in such a way that the forests are not destroyed. So this could be cultivation on the fringes of the forest on a small scale, collection of fallen wood, collection of minor forest produce like honey or other kinds of leaves, collection of bamboo for making their houses, fences, roofs, and so on. Finally, the government of India agreed, and the Forest Rights Act was passed in 2006. There were significant impediments to implementation of this law. In fact, what I noticed was some of you have already sent me some questions about why there is so much of a problem in by implementing environmental legislation and how do we teach this to our students. So this particular short 10-minute video, which is made by the people of the village themselves, a very, very interesting video. Unfortunately, it's in Hindi. That means that those of you who do not know Hindi will not be able to understand it, but you can get somebody to translate it for you. Okay, it depicts the long struggle from the colonial time to the present to bring about this change in law, and then to get this law implemented by the Forest Department. Even though in this particular case, the Environment Minister of India and the Chief Minister of Maharashtra were supporting them, so you can see that it's not a simple question of power. It's also a question of the Forest Department, which stood to gain huge amounts of money by maintaining an exclusive right over forests. So this is also an experiment in resource governance. So the Forest Rights Act for the first time says that every family which is defined as forest dependent, which are mostly tribals and lower caste people in India, can get 2 acres of land for cultivation, and they can also access forest resources in many different ways. So the transformation of governing forest as a resource, which provided equitable access, which ensured more sustainable use of the forest, okay, and reduced conflicts between the Forest Department and the people, that is something that you can show through this video, but through other kinds of case studies relating to the Forest Rights Act. The most famous environmental movement, not only in India but around the world, is the Narmada movement against the Sardar Sarovar project, which is actually not one dam, but a series of very large dams, over 30 big dams and over 100 medium and small dams on the Sardar Sarovar, on the Narmada River, across Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat, and Maharashtra. So this also becomes a very interesting case study for students because it enables us to bring in the technology issue, the environmental sustainability issue, the development issue, the resettlement issue, okay, and disasters. So if you begin discussing things, you will see that generally a lot of political leaders are trying to pull a lot of wool over our eyes. So generally the projected benefits from large dams are given as these: irrigation, drinking water, hydroelectric power, and flood control, and so on. But the Indian context is such that rains actually fall only during certain months of the year. During other seasons, you need to provide irrigation drinking water. But if you try to release water for drinking irrigation, you cannot maintain the reservoir level at a certain reservoirs at a certain level to generate electricity. And with increasing climate and monsoon variability, it's becoming very unpredictable how much water will flow into the reservoir. So we see that dams, rather than act as flood control mechanisms, actually create more floods. We've seen it in Tungabhadra, we've seen it in Kosi, we've seen it in the case of many other dams as well. So what you see is that there is a certain idea of how dam as a technology can be used, and there is a certain reality, and between these two there is a very big gap, which results in a lot of adverse consequences both for the environment and for people. One of the interesting things we can talk about here, you know, earlier we were talking about the inequalities between developed countries and developing countries. And in the case of dams, it's the opposite. The developed countries have largely given up construction of large dams. America and Australia together have decided to decommission over 700 dams, okay? Largely because dams, largely because of economic issues. They're simply not feasible. The cost of desiltation is so high that after 40 years it becomes too expensive to maintain given the benefits. Whereas India and China are among the few countries which continue to go in for this technology, okay? So who is it benefiting? What? Why are we going in for it? Does it make sense? These are kind of questions you can discuss. But there's sufficiently good material integrating the technology, engineering, and social science aspects in the case of dams. So they become very interesting cases to provide a multidisciplinary perspective on environmental issues to students. Of course, there are movements against other dams also. Sundar Lal Bahuguna has been involved in the anti-Terry dam movement. Also, there are many of these dams are located in seismic areas, which may has consequences for earthquakes and so on. And there are also other kinds of positive examples. There is the Bali Raja Dam in Maharashtra, which is a dam, people's dam. So it's a different kind of dam built by people themselves, and it has a different kind of technology, engineering, which is supposedly more environmentally sensitive. We also have these alternatives in the form of small-scale water solutions. So as I had mentioned earlier, historically, south of the Vindhyas, there have been these thousands and thousands of village water tanks. The historian and mathematician D.D. Kosambi has written extensively about this. So they provide drinking water for human beings and animals. They provide source of irrigation. And with new technologies, some of these small-scale water bodies also generate energy, electricity, like this village called Bilgaon, where one of the activists of Narmada Bachao Andolan, in association with some of our alumnus in IIT Bombay, developed hydroelectric power from these small water bodies. This example was shown in the movie Swadesh, where Shah Rukh Khan became a hero by providing electricity to a small village. Okay, the original heroes are from here in IIT Bombay and in the Narmada Bachao Andolan. Okay. Yeah. On the right side is a project that we in IIT, some of us together, also constructed for a village close to Mumbai. So there are a lot of small-scale water solutions which provide the same development benefits without the adverse consequences of larger dams. So I think when we talk to students, it should not all be negative. One can also look at alternative kind of technology solutions which are more socially, economically, as well as environmentally sensitive. And in fact, that's one of the things that movements like the NBA, the Narmada Bachao Andolan, have been saying, that they're not against technology, they're not against dams per se, they're against certain kinds of dams, they're for other kinds of technologies. I earlier mentioned this case, so I will not go into this in detail. Those of you from Kerala may already be familiar with this. So this is the famous case of private ownership versus public access to water. The interesting thing about this was that for the first time, this brought into the public domain the issue of groundwater. So groundwater exploitation has been going on a very large scale, But there were hardly any social movements around this because it was affecting individuals, and it was not something that was visible because it was water in the aquifers underground which was getting scarce. But this was the first case where a movement started against increasing exploitation of groundwater. Initially, Coca-Cola won the case in the High Court because there was no law against groundwater. Okay, so eventually, the government of Kerala came up with a law. The state of Maharashtra also has a groundwater law now. Many other states also are coming up with laws. There's also a groundwater bill which has been pending with the central government for 5-6 years. Okay, so groundwater as an environmental issue has become serious in recent years, and those of you who are interested in using this as a case study, the groundwater as a case study, may take up this environmental movement against Coca-Cola in Kerala, in this village called Plachimada. We move now into this issue of the legal aspects. Now, whether it is struggles or conflicts or environmental movements, they can have a long-term sustainable impact on how we manage the environment effectively only if they end up in the form of better laws and rules and regulations and institutions to manage these resources better. And in fact, many of these movements have supported the change of laws and regulations, and the Forest Rights Act is one example that I've given you. Environment Protection Act of 1986 also emerged in response to the concerns of a lot of environmentalists about the impacts of various development projects in India post-independence. So we are moving into this aspect of the legal aspects of environmental issues. In the UGC syllabus, a number of acts, environmental acts, are identified. And these are probably the most difficult to teach because unless you are a lawyer making a lot of money, teaching what laws is very boring. You have various sections, subsections, sub-subsections, all kinds of things. And your head starts spinning once you go into all those sections. And we can't just ask our students. They are not going to be, they may become lawyers earlier. They are engineers. They take up various kinds of careers. It's not important for them to know about all these provisions, but a general awareness about the provisions is important, which will be useful for their own careers. But more than that, what is required is to understand the spirit behind these laws. Why do these laws exist? What are their motivations? What kind of positive environmental actions do they promote? What kind of negative environmental actions do they seek to prevent? So those are the kind of questions which we should make students aware of. So using these kinds of examples, the Forest Rights Act and Environment Protection Act I mentioned here, you can use both video as well as research material to teach students about what are the key issues, what are the motivations for these laws to come into existence in the first place, what kind of institutions did they set up at the village level, district level, or the national level. Are these laws being implemented properly? If not, do they result in conflicts? What is the role of science here? So in the Forest Rights Act, for example, the law follows the science, but in the interpretation, sometimes the Forest Department forgets about science. So if you look at this video on Lekha Menda village in Gadchiroli district, you find a very interesting example where timber, bamboo, as we know, is a species of grass as per biology, as per botanical science. However, the Forest Department classified it as timber. And they said, therefore, since timber cannot be cut by local people, cutting bamboo is a crime. Okay, how even science can be subverted by people with vested interests is something that you see. But what is also interesting for us, you know, like in the case of the large dams, often there is spurious science. Sometimes there is good, sensible science as well. So since you're going to be talking to engineering students, it'll be very interesting if you can bring in a discussion about what is the nature of science and technology that goes into the making of these laws and the implementation of these laws. A similar thing happened with reference to the movement against GM crops, genetically modified crops. If you look at BT brinjal, for example, you know, the previous environment minister, in his great wisdom, asked all kinds of scientists to give their opinion, you know, physicists, astronomers, mechanical engineers, to give their opinion on BT brinjal. And these wise people, instead of saying, we don't know much about it, said, yes, this is a good technology, you can approve it. So the way in which decisions involving science are made is something that we should be very aware of, and that we see in many of these environmental movements where such questions have been raised quite often about what is science and what kind of science are we talking about. Okay. When we talk about the outcome of these projects, it's also important that we talk to them about certain kinds of positive reinforcing mechanisms or positive institutional mechanisms that ordinary people have access to because of these laws. So social impact assessment did not exist before 1986. It was mandated by the Environmental Protection Act. So that has been made use of by many movements to ensure that the adverse impacts of projects can be minimized. So if we want to talk about resettlement and rehabilitation, for example, that owes its origin primarily to the mandatory requirement of social impact assessment in the Environmental Protection Act of 1986. But we also know that most of these laws exist largely in violation. So many of these laws are violated, some more than others, which means that there are problems in ensuring effective implementation of these laws. Just as I said that, you know, it's very boring for us to teach students about the various provisions of the Act, it's equally boring for me to teach you about these different environmental legislation and acts. Therefore, since all of you are already involved in this course, I have put to you these two questions. So we will learn from each other. We will mutually learn from each other. So these are the two questions I have put to you. Number one, since enforcement of environmental legislation is a problem, how do you teach this? And interestingly, I noticed when I went back home after telling you about this assignment yesterday, I noticed that a lot of you had already asked me this question, that you are doing this in the classroom and we are finding it difficult to talk about why, despite the existence of laws, there are so many environmental problems. So some of you have asked me this question and posed it as one of the difficulties or challenges in the classroom. The second is how to teach environmental laws without boring the students to death. So I gave you some of the environmental laws. I also gave you links to the actual laws themselves and asked you to do a preliminary reading and then tell us how, either how you have addressed these challenges or how you think we should address these two issues. Okay. Now I'm going to give you a couple of minutes to articulate your thoughts on these two issues, maybe even write it down in your papers or notebooks, and then I will call upon some of you to share your views on this with us and with the rest of the centers and participants. Let's start with Marathwada.
Yes, I got the question, sir.
Okay.
So we can teach this about the environmental laws and everything by giving examples to the students in the way they like they were like movies, like the scenes seen in movies, or they like the stories in movies, the soap movies or the stories that they equally like to listen. Mm-hmm. Okay, sir, by giving some examples that they like, or by the giving some examples by our day-to-day life example, what they face.
Yes, MGM, Nanded.
Sir, teaching this issue is not a problem in law, because at the time of teaching these law points, we have to first of all raise the issue. What is the issue? And depending upon that issue, if we are explaining the issue first, then the laws are there to solve the problem of that issue. This is a style in which law faculties are teaching.
Okay, that's I think is an excellent strategy that you are following. Yeah, relating it to issues rather than to take them as standalone topics. Yeah. Anything else you wish to add?
Sir, one more thing that regarding minerals, I have given one question, and that question is connected with this Samata case. Mm-hmm. That we want to know about the basic issues and what are its effect on the society, and whether the judgment is implemented by the government or not.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. Good afternoon, VNIT.
Yes, my question is how politics affects the environmental law or making of the laws.
Yes. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
So there is one more question.
Okay, somebody else.
Sir, 10 years before I was visited to the Pooch National Park, and at the night time, I heard the sound of bicycle, approximate 200 bicycles. They were going to the catching fish there, and they take out the fish and sold in the market. So such type of example I was given to the student, and by Wildlife Protection Act as well as fishing should be prohibited in that particular area, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay, SGS Institute, Indore.
Good evening, sir. This is an answer to the second question which you asked, which was how best to teach environmental laws to students without boring them. So I think what we could do is first discuss a case of degradation taking place in the nearby areas, and then ask them to draft a possible solution as to what do they think that could be done. After that, what we can do is to show a similarity between the actual law and what they have given their thoughts about. In that way, they'll be able to appreciate the law in a better manner.
Okay.
Thank you.
That's an excellent way of doing this. Thank you. Okay, MEPCO, good afternoon.
Any change in the attitude of society will help the environment? Because our society having both educated and uneducated people are as well as rural as well as urban areas. The change in attitude, it will help the environment actually in the course. In what point of view it will help the environment?
You're talking about a change in attitude.
Change in attitude of the society.
Okay, but how is that related to the questions that I asked you?
Sir, actually regarding the acts, how to teach the acts to the students, you know, what was suggested by the previous college, I do agree with that. Thinking that if students were given opportunity to think on their own and finding solutions from their side and comparing it with the existing law, it will be highly interesting.
Okay.
Rather than just giving the law in a raw manner,
okay,
if we just give them opportunity to go for thinking, it will
okay
be very good.
Okay. Shivakasi, where you are located, is one of the most polluted cities in India. So,
yeah, sure. Sure.
So I think especially this course is very important there. So have you actually visited, as teachers, all of you, and with your students, have you visited some of these
yes,
environmentally
sir
polluted areas?
Yes, sir. We have industrial visits inside from the college. When the student get into the college, we are arranging for industrial visit,
mm-hmm,
through which the engineering students are given opportunity to know about what sort of pollution that is happening in and around Swahasi.
Okay. So do these industries allow you to visit
yeah
the polluted sites?
Not only polluted sites,
ah,
yeah, I mean industries. So they will get an overall idea about the
okay
nature of pollution, the
mm
pollutant and all.
Okay. I would like to ask one question, because even as per the
yeah
UGC syllabus for this course, the last module includes field visits. So how many of you actually you know, carry out these field visits with your students? Please raise your hand. Those of you who carry out these field visits, please raise your hands. Okay.
Everyone.
Everyone. Okay.
Field visit, everyone will go, sir.
Everyone will do. Okay. That's good.
Yeah, yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah.
Other than industrial visits, any other places you visited?
Yes, sir. The thing is, what I mean is, even in the first year, students were given opportunity to visit industries, fireworks, matchworks, match industry, printing press, which is located in and around Sivakasi, sir. Mm.
No, but is there a specific environmental component to these visits?
Still now it was not there, sir.
Not there, okay, okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. This is NMIMS, Shirpur. I would like to ask you a question that I asked the previous college teachers also. How many of you are involved in going to environmentally degraded areas to experience at first hand the environmental problems with the students? Please raise your hands. Those of you who take the students on field trips to study environmental issues, please raise your hand.
Yes, regarding this trips, field trips for the students at various places regarding the environment concerns, we have been visiting nearby industries over here. Regarding the recently, we have visited a kind of an effluent treatment plant over there, and nearby the industries, textile industries over here.
Okay.
So we are carrying out such kind of visit over here.
Okay. See, if you look at this environmental studies course, the focus is on different dimensions and aspects of the environment. Apart from industrial pollution, there's a focus on forestry, solid waste management, water, pasture, grazing land, soil. So many different kinds of resources. So other than industry, do you also focus on other kinds of environmental problems? Do you visit other
Regarding here at Shirpur, we are having at Shirpur, we are having a kind of a water conservation system over here, which is called as Shirpur pattern. And we are over here created a series of check dams.
Okay.
And those kind of check dams are used for water conservation systems over there.
Okay.
So we are also taking our students over there. So just
okay, that's very good. And do any of you also have a response to the question that I had asked about how to teach these laws?
Regarding that teaching the environmental laws, myself, I have taught the subject, and to explain the students regarding the importance of environmental laws over there, we just create different kind of case studies, real life case studies, where the kind of judgment has been issued by the Supreme Court or High Court,
okay,
and explaining the students regarding the importance of aspect of law,
okay,
and the implications to not
okay
following the laws for their
okay
what kind of consequences can be faced.
Okay.
So this creates an interest among the students over there. Thank you.
Okay, Amrita School of Engineering, Kollam.
I would actually get the students emotionally involved so that they are not bored.
Mm-hmm.
And I would show them the film of an example,
mm-hmm,
of some kind of some kind of violation of an environmental law. For example, some displacement. And then that the students would actually really feel compassionate. And then I would discuss possible solutions. And the most important thing is to get the students emotionally involved and really want to find out how to help these people. And then they will also be interested in knowing which kind of laws there actually are.
Okay. Thank you. And it's the first time I'm hearing these two words, compassion and emotion with reference to the environment, and not surprisingly it comes from Amrita. So because the concept of affect, you know, which is related to emotions, it's very important that students are not just sensitive but they can empathize with environmental issues, so that they don't then also are able to comprehend the more serious technical social science and theoretical concepts. So thank you for that response. Okay, thank you. So, yeah, I see a lot more of you have your hands up. Please do send me your responses via Moodle, and we'll consolidate them. And if any more responses are required from my side, I'll make sure I respond to you via Moodle. Most of you have given your own responses to my questions. There were two questions which required my responses, so I'll just respond to them briefly in the 5 minutes that is available to us. So one is about this Samata judgment, which one of you asked for. In fact, it is not really a well-known judgment, though it deserves to be much better known. So the Samata judgment is in fact what is called as a case law, though it has not been converted into a law because it is a Supreme Court judgment. So it's the first judgment of its kind where the Supreme Court acknowledges that there is a development imperative of extracting minerals. On the other hand, it also acknowledges the fact that there is a lot of degradation of the environment and displacement of people due to mining activities. So it has tried to arrive at some kind of a via media solution where people's permissions are taken, some kind of royalty is given to the local people, and restrictions are imposed on how much of activities can take place, what technology choices can be made by the different parties involved. And the Supreme Court suggested that all the chief ministers of all states get together to begin implementing this case law, this judgment. That was never done, as I mentioned to you earlier. But if you do not want to talk only about violations and the negative aspects, so here is a kind of a positive way of addressing these very difficult kinds of environment, human conflict kind of situations. So I will upload this judgment on Moodle. It's also, you can search for it on the internet and get it. But it's one of the few which laid the basis for a more consensual and discursive approach to solving these environmental kind of conflicts. And for the first time in Orissa, this judgment, I think last year, was put into practice, where using our 73rd amendment to the Constitution, it was decided that every village will vote to decide whether this project should be permitted or not. So people were given that permission, they voted, and on that basis the final decision was taken. So there is a process that is available to us to make decisions in these kind of cases. It's only when those processes are not followed do we have those kinds of conflicts and struggles. Secondly, the political effects, how politics affects making environment laws. So that's a very interesting question. I have one of my PhD students there who's working on coastal regulation zones. The coastal regulation zone is not only the most violated law in India, it's also the most amended law in India. The fact that you have to amend a law 27 times in 20 years shows that there is a lot of politics affecting it. Okay? So there have been this, but also the CRZ has had much more public consultation both with experts and with ordinary people. So it shows both the negatives and positives of developing environmental legislation in a democracy like India, where a lot of public consultation has come in and people's views have been heard, including people directly dependent on resources like the fishing communities, for example, living in coastal areas. On the other hand, there have also been a lot of pressures in the last 20 years to set up a lot of development projects in coastal areas, tourism projects and so on, and because of which constantly this law has been amended to dilute its provisions. Okay, so the effect of politics is most visible here. In the case of most other laws, at least in principle, the law has not been subject to much political influence, and there has been a lot of influence of experts, technical experts, people working with resources, environmental scientists and so on in the making of those laws. But politics is seen in the form of violation of these laws, not in the making of these laws. So with that, I will stop here.